Well, now that we've gotten that done, we can kind of relax, can't we? Yeah, this is a very happy occasion, and we congratulate these parents and these extended families. As we think about dedication and baby dedication and families, I'd like for us to read the scripture from Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 4 through 7. You see it on the screen. Would you read that with me, please? Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be a part of your heart. Impress this on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk among the road and when you lie down and when you get up. This is a very wonderful scripture and teaching for parents, for extended families, and for a whole church. I would like to say just a word of compliment. I believe this church does a wonderful job of loving and teaching and training our babies and our children and our youth. And a lot of people put a lot of time and effort and prayer into it, and it really does show. And you'll notice one thing, that the children in this church are real happy. If you don't believe it, just stand in the foyer and watch them run up and down and scream. They just love to come to this church. These children have obviously been born physically into their earthly families, and we celebrate that today. The birth of a child is always a gift from God. It is our prayer that as they grow, the parents, the extended family, the church, the Sunday school teachers, the Awana teachers, will help them to begin to understand, number one, who Jesus Christ is. Number two, how much He loves them. And number three, the great sacrifice that He made at the cross so that they and we might experience what only God can do, and that is the wonderful forgiveness of sin and salvation of soul. This spiritual experience, becoming a believer, a follower of Jesus Christ, which is what we want, pray for, and hope for all of our children and all of our grandchildren. The other day I was with a family, and they had a 5-year-old and a 7-year-old and a 9-year-old. And I just said hello to them at the place where I was. And I said, you know, I go to a church that loves children. Do you all know who Jesus Christ is? And those children had a blank look on their face. And I thought, how sad to be a 5-year-old, a 7-year-old, and a 9-year-old, and you don't know the most important person in all of history and who he is and what he can do. And so, children, I know you don't always believe this, but you are very blessed to be born into a family that knows and loves and serves Jesus Christ. You are so very blessed. Jesus called this salvation experience, you must be born again. You must be born again. The must adds an urgency to it. You must be not only physically born, but you must be spiritually born. Or, the Bible says, it's very dangerous because it says, if you do not place your life and your faith in Jesus Christ, in the words of Jesus, you will die in your sin and spend eternity in hell. And in order for that not to happen, Jesus raised his hand and said, Father, I will go. I will go and become the sacrifice that they might have forgiveness of sin and salvation of soul. And so we put a lot of emphasis on how much Jesus loves us. That's why the Son of God, Jesus Christ, came all the way from heaven to become what John the Baptizer called the Lamb of God who takes away our sin. Now, this was our Heavenly Father's plan in order to rescue us from our sin, ourself, Satan, and death. Jesus Christ is that bridge that makes it possible for us to come to our Heavenly Father. Yes, Jesus Christ came, would you believe, from the glory of heaven as a baby? That is unexplainable. That the God of heaven and earth, the King of kings, the creator of heaven and earth, would be willing to come as a baby in order that we might understand who God is. That's why at Christmas time, we love Christmas, because we celebrate the coming of the Savior. And we sing Emmanuel, Emmanuel, which means God with us. Do you realize how important that is? That means that from that moment on, you are never alone. God is with us. That should give us every day some courage and some strength and some patience and a very Christian perspective on what's going on in this world. That the eternal, holy, all-knowing, all-power, creator of heaven and earth would go that far to save you and me from our sins. About a year ago, our longtime friend Emmett Sullivan, who at one time was chief of chaplains of all the Department of Criminal Justice, the prison system of the state of Texas, who, by the way, was my boss, battled cancer for about 2 years. But in the 20 years, Emmett and Jan were wonderful friends to Glee and myself. By the way, some of you may not realize, Glee, would you stand up? This is my wife. Okay. We went through Emmett's years of cancer and all. When he died, we drove from San Antonio to Huntsville to the funeral. And when we got there, Jan was standing in the foyer. And as we walked up, and Glee was first, Jan said, "You came that far?" In other words, you love us that much? When we say that the God of heaven and earth came all the way from the glory of heaven to earth, that tells us how much He loves us. And He would not have come if we did not desperately need Him. You don't ever take somebody to the ER unless they are desperately sick. You don't ever give somebody a blood transfusion unless they are very low in their body. And so when we say that the God of heaven came as an infant to become our Savior, says He loves us a lot and we need Him very much. This wonderful, loving, forgiving Son of God willingly Remember, Jesus was not a victim. Jesus was not a victim. It was all the plan of God that he would come, he would grow to maturity without sin, he would begin teaching and preaching and healing and baptizing, and then in confrontation with the religious leaders, he would be tried, though not guilty. He would be beaten, though never having done anything wrong, and he would be executed on a Roman cross. As Isaiah predicted it hundreds of years before, in order that we might have forgiveness of sin, salvation of soul, a brand new life, a brand new family, and a heavenly Father forever. And by the way, that's why we celebrate Easter. You see, Easter is the good news. He is risen. Our God is not dead. You know, Buddha's buried and Muhammad is buried. And you can go to their tombs. But there is no tomb of Jesus Christ. His tomb is empty because he's alive. And he's here. And he's with us. And he knows us. And he knows our needs. And he is with us every moment of every day. Don't ever forget that. You're never alone. You're never without help. You're never without strength because he is always with you. This spiritual experience happens when by the Holy Spirit we become convicted of our sin, realize that we are helpless to forgive and save ourselves, and we turn to Jesus Christ, Lord, forgive me, have mercy upon me. You see, in the plan of God, we are given an earthly family. One man and one woman meet, date, fall in love, marry, and begin to have a family. In case you don't realize it, that's how we all got here. We all got here the same way. Mothers, we are so thankful for you. I am so thankful for my mother. I am so thankful that I was born in a home that my mother and father loved and served the Lord. As a little boy like Bennett, on Sunday morning, of course, I came along late. My parents were 40 years old when I was born, so you know what a shock I was. But on Sunday morning, my father was the greeter at the door of the church. And so I would be standing right beside him. I'm so thankful that I had a father that knew and loved and served the Lord. I had friends that didn't have that. And some of them wound up in prison. Some of them made some major mistakes because they didn't have a Sunday school teacher. They didn't have a deacon. They didn't have a church family to train and mold and help them to become people that knew and loved and served God. Mothers, I love in the Old Testament, Moses' mother, her name was Jochebed. Jochebed was expecting a child, but the trouble is she was in Egypt and she was an Israelite slave. And the bad news was that the Egyptian Pharaoh said, all the Israelite baby boys have to be thrown into the river to be eaten by the crocodiles. And so what was she to do? What was she to do? And you can just see Jochebed with her husband, with the older brother and sister, and they begin to pray, Lord, what can we do to save this baby? Moses was a beautiful baby. And the Lord gave them a plan. They were to make a basket and waterproof it and put Moses in it and go down to the river close to where the princess, the Egyptian princess, bathed every day. And you put it in so that she couldn't miss this little floating basket. And you know what? The princess saw the baby, of course, like all women. Oh, this baby, you know, this sweet baby. She took that baby home and adopted it. You see, God saved that baby. He'd do the same for you and for your baby every day. Remember that. The Lord loves you as and your baby as much as he did Jochebed and Moses. You're never alone. You're never without God's help. He is always there for you. Sometimes it's not so easy to be a mother, is it? You know, there was this mom at the end of the day, tired, and not everything had gone right, and of course the kids hadn't behaved all day long, and this there was a knock on a door, a local pastor. Ma'am, I'm representing the local children's home, and I wondered if you might have anything you'd like to donate to the children's home. Oh, you guys are so fast. And the mother stood there for a minute, you know, you can just see that look on her face, and she looks at those children, she says, yes, I can donate one boy or two girls, which would you like? Yeah, yeah. Well, fathers, it's very important that you understand something that you already understand, and that is, you are your children's hero. Fathers, you are your children's hero. That puts you in a place of great opportunity. See, they look to you, they love you, and they want your love. And so, you see, your children are going to believe what you believe, they're going to love what you love, they're going to say what you say, and they're going to do what you do. You have a great opportunity and responsibility. Fathers, you are so important because you are your child's hero. And guess what? If you love Jesus Christ, they will. If you love and read your Bible to your children, they will. If you pray for and with your children, they will. If you are the one that on Sunday morning gets a whole family up and we're going to Sunday school and we're going to church because this is a wonderful time with our church family, they're going to see it the same way. You see, fathers, you have a great opportunity because you are the hero. That means that there's some things that are very important, and that is, from the very beginning, start talking to your children. Children want to be talked to. They want to be listened to. But you see, now, that will take time. And it takes your undivided attention. Yes, that means you go over and you turn that television off. Yeah. Turn that football game off. Your children are a lot more important than any football game ever was. And you're going to turn your phone off. And you're going to give exactly what your children want so much. They want your undivided attention. They want to know that without a doubt you are accepted, you are loved, you are wanted, and you are valuable. and they will carry that in their heart the rest of their lives. Fathers, it's so important. I have a spinning reel that my grandson gave me a few years ago. But you know, for some reason, I haven't gotten much use out of it. I wonder why. It's still in the box. Dads, is your Bible still in the wrapper or in the box? Your Bible needs to be. Yours. Your children need to sense that it's something that you love and is very important and is the most important book in the world. And they need to see you open that. They need to hear you read that to them. They need you to tell the story of Moses and Jochebed and the basket and the baby. Because when you tell it, they're going to believe it. You have such a great opportunity. You have such a great opportunity to mold and train and love these children. And you say, how in the world am I going to do that? The Lord is going to give you everything you need every day, one day at a time. He'll give you all the wisdom, all the courage, all the patience, all the strength. He's going to give you all you need every day because Jesus wants your child to become a Christian even more than you do. Jesus wants your child one of these days to be a dad on the front row dedicating their baby. Jesus wants more than anything else for your baby to sing in the choir and worship the Lord. Jesus wants more than anything else for you to be a Sunday school teacher or part of the church family, to lead the youth group. You see, Jesus has great plans for your baby. And you are a very important part. The mom and the dad, the grandmother, the grandfather, the uncles, the aunts, all of you are the team that God has put together. And it all starts when you make Jesus Christ the center of your life. That's where it all, that's the wonderful transforming experience, because when you do, you become a new person. And you have a new family, and you have a heavenly Father for the rest of your life. And so my question today is, are you ready? Are you ready? Are you ready to make Jesus Christ the center of your life? Or maybe you're already a Christian, and you live in this area. You want a church that loves you and your children and your youth. And this church does. And my question this morning, are you ready to join with us and love and rear and train these children and your children? We're going to give you that opportunity in just a moment. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Heavenly Father, we help you. We hope that by your Holy Spirit, you would help us to come to the place today that we would confess our sins and place our faith in Jesus Christ and become a believer and a follower of Jesus Christ. We pray that today, as some are praying and seeking a church for their family, that your Holy Spirit will guide them. And we thank you for doing this. In Christ's name we pray, amen.